Welcome to the video lecture series on sociology. Today we'll be talking about social groups from the chapter 2nd from class 11 sociology textbook, and the name of the chapter is Terms and Concepts and Their Use in Sociology. Now when we talk about social groups, various sociologists and anthropologists, they categorize the groups into different categories. Now when they categorize these groups into different types, they actually, you know, they were struck by differences between the close, intimate, face-to-face interaction in the traditional societies and impersonal, detached, distant interaction in modern societies. So whatever the distinction which was done by the sociologist and anthropologist was on the basis of the interaction which was having in the traditional societies and in the modern society and the difference between those interactions. Now the complete contrast is not accurate description of reality, because when we talk about, you know, the traditional societies and when we talk about the modern society, one is that the traditional society, the society which were there earlier, I mean they kept on changing. So we cannot say that, you know, these are the only two groups which are there, you know, social groups are there, and this is what we talk about in sociology. Now when we talk about groups, we talk about various types of groups. We talk about primary and secondary social groups. We talk about community and society and association, in-groups and out-groups, reference groups and peer groups. And these are the groups which we'll be discussing today. So let us first talk about primaries and secondary group. When we talk about these groups, I mean it is based on, you know, the number of people who are involved in that particular group and kind of interaction they are having in that group. Say for example, when we talk about primary group, I mean it's a small group of people, they are connected by intimate and face-to-face association and cooperation. And there is a strong sense of belonging, and the example of primary groups are family, village, friends. These are all, you know, the primary group, and all these things comes into primary group. Now when we talk about secondary, I mean they are very large in size and they maintain a formal and impersonal relationship. One very important point that distinguishes between a primary and a secondary group. Now the primary group is the person oriented and the secondary groups are goal oriented. Say for example, when we talk about school, they are secondary groups because we have a one particular group and there are large number of people and there are large number of student teachers. They are part of that particular group, but they have one same goal. And similarly, the government offices, hospitals, students' associations, they are all secondary groups. In addition to the point which we have just discussed now, that is about, you know, having, you know, certain goals, and this is what differentiates between primary group and a secondary group, there are a number of other issues which differentiates between primary and a secondary social group. One is the emotional intensity. When we talk about the relationship and the interaction in the primary group, you know, the intensity of these relationship and the emotional intensity of these relationships are very high. The second is scope. When we talk about primary group, the individual's entire personality is important to the group, whereas in secondary, only a small piece of an individual's personality is important. Say for an example, in an office, you know, if, you know, it is a publication house, the person who is good at editing, I mean, he is good for that particular organization. So here the individual's, a small piece of his personality or her personality is important. Then another thing is particularism and universalism. Each individual is important in a primary group. The group is particular about who can be a member. Say for example, like we have a group of close friends. So we are very particular who would be the member of our group. You know, that is what the primary group is all about. Wherever when we talk about secondary group, there, like, it's open for all. Whosoever wants to be a member of that particular group has a chance to become a member of that particular group. Now on the basis of the interaction which, you know, the group members are having in their group, in primary group the interaction is very informal. Whereas in secondary group, you know, the interaction is very formal and rules exist to explain how and when interaction takes place. Now the aims, when we talk about primary, the goal is simply to enjoy each other's company. Whereas in secondary, the group, you know, must have a specific reason to be together. The members may have a little in common beyond the reason or the group's existence. Now, the rules and regulation, when we talk about rules and regulation in the primary group and in the, you know, the secondary group, rules and regulation in primary groups are there, but, you know, they are not the written rules. Say, for example, in our family, we do have rules. We know that we have to be at home at 8 o'clock or 9 o'clock, but these rules are not written rules. They are unwritten rules and they are very flexible rules. But whenever we talk about the secondary group, the rules and regulations are there. There are fixed rules and regulation, and even the punishment also, like in primary, I mean, it's not the fixed punishment. We have the flexibility to choose, you know, the kind of punishment which we want to give to any of, you know, the member of that particular group based on, you know, what kind of, you know, the rules were broken. But in secondary group, you know, the punishment is also, I mean, it's written. You have a fixed punishment for breaking any sort of rules in that particular group. Let's talk about a community and society or association. In community, human relationships that are highly personal, intimate, and enduring, a person's involvement is considerable. While when we talk about society or association, it refers to everything opposite of community. And in society, when we talk about, you know, this interaction, the interaction is very impersonal, superficial, and the relationship which we are talking about, they are very transitory, and it actually reflects, you know, the modern urban life. You know, this is the main difference between the community and, you know, the society or any association. And if we have to put community into a primary or a secondary group category, then the community is a primary group where the relationship is very intimate, and the association comes under the secondary group, where the relationship is impersonal, where there are fixed rules and regulations. Now, let's talk about in-groups and out-group. Now, in-groups is like something which differentiates us and we from they and them, right? Take an example, a group of students from a one particular school can form an in-group against the students of other schools. So, a sense of belonging makes an in-group. If we are part of one particular group, then we say that yes, we are into that particular group, and that is called an in-group. An out-group is one to which the member of, you know, in-group do not belong. Say, for example, you know, the out-group is the group which is formed by the students of other school, that becomes an out-group, and we are not a member of that particular out-group. And members of out-groups can face hostile reactions from the members of in-group, and it happens many a times. An actual definition of who belongs and who does not changes with the time and social context. You know, this is a very important thing, you know, I mean, and this is very flexible when we talk about in-groups and out-groups. At one point of time, you know, there could be a number of people who can be considered as out-group, but with the time and with the changing of, you know, the context and the relationship, they can be a part of that particular group. So it keeps changing. Now, let's talk about reference groups. Now, reference groups are other groups who we look up to and aspire to be like. You know, there are many people whom we want to be like, and these are the, you know, the reference group. These are the people from the reference group. The groups whose lifestyles are emulated and are known as reference groups. You know, these are the people whom we want to copy, whom we want to emulate. We look up to them and we dream to be like these people, and these are the part of, you know, the reference group. We are not the part of reference group, they are the people, and we always want to be like them. And reference groups are important source of information about culture, lifestyle, aspirations, and goal attainments. And we look up to these people, you know, for like whenever, you know, there's an issue of, you know, fashion or a lifestyle, or like if we have to set certain goals, or if you have to, you know, select certain career. So we look up to these people and make our decisions and get inspired by these people. Now, these are the groups which we have just talked about, are mentioned in your textbook. And other than this, you know, there are number of groups, and the way we actually discussed about, you know, the definition of sociology, and we told you very clearly that, you know, there is no one definition as such about sociology, like what sociology is all about. There is, you know, there are divergent views, and similarly it happens in, like, when we talk about the social groups also. So here we have just discussed, you know, five or six types of group, but there are number of sociologists. They have their own classification. They classified, you know, the groups into the different categories. So we'll just have a very quick look at, you know, the what kind of groups are there and how, I mean, these groups are explained by the different sociologists. Now, when we look at the Dwight Sanderson, he said that there are three types of group. One is involuntary group, voluntary group, and the delegate group. Involuntary group is like, you know, when we talk about the blood relationship, right? And the voluntary group is like on our own will, we became a part of one particular group. And the delegate group is like if we are representing certain people, and if we are elected by, you know, a group of people, and when we go and become a part of that particular group, then that becomes a delegate group. Now, according to Tony's, I mean, he says that, you know, the groups, there are two types of groups. He talked about community and society, which we have already discussed. Community means that there is a very strong interaction between the people of the community. And we talked about that there is a very intimate relationship between the people in the community, and there is a strong sense of belonging. Whereas when we talk about society, we discuss that, you know, the relationship is very impersonal, very superficial, and it's always in the transitory phase. I mean, it keeps changing with the time and with the context. Now, another classification was by Giddings. He said that there is one genetic group, there is one congregate group, disjunctive group, and overlapping group. Now, genetic group, like we just talked about, you know, when we said the involuntary group, it's the similar to involuntary group, which is like the blood relationships. Then the congregate groups, it's the combination of, you know, like if we really want to be a member of one particular group, we have the similar interest, we became part of that particular group. Then you have the disjunctive group, right? Disjunctive group is the group wherein, you know, one particular group does not allow you to be the member of the other group. Then it is a disjunctive group. And then the fourth one is the overlapping group. Overlapping group is the group wherein, you know, you are a member of one particular group, but that group, the membership of that group, allows you to be the member of other groups as well. So these are the types of, you know, the groups we have. Another classification was given by George Hassens, and he classified it into around four categories. He says there is one unsocial group. Now, unsocial group is a group of people who are not very social, asocial, who lives in isolation. And then comes the pseudo-social group. The pseudo-social group, they say that, you know, it's a group of people, I mean, who are involved in a lot of social activities. But whatever social activities they are involved in, they are not, you know, in favor of society, or they are not in a way contributing to the development of society. You know, it's only for their own pleasure that, you know, they are interacting with each other with no cause, you know, as far as the development of society is concerned or the welfare of the society is concerned. Then comes the antisocial group. Now, antisocial group, we all understand, you know, if we work, any member of, you know, that particular group or any group that works against the welfare of society, that's an antisocial group. And then he talked about the pro-social group, which is the complete contrast of the antisocial group, wherein we actually work for the welfare of the society, wherein we talk about certain issues, we talk about certain cause, we take measures to achieve certain goals which can benefit the society. This is what George Hassens talk about. So today we talked about social groups, and we talked about, you know, what are the different groups which are there in society and what is the difference between all these groups. So as a student of sociology, you can try to figure out which group do you belong to. And especially when we talked about a reference group, you know, if you can do this for yourself, you can actually find out like which reference group do you have and how do you emulate, you know, the members of that particular group. And does it, you know, help you in any way? So this you have to find it out. I mean, you can observe and you can share your findings with us. We have created a Google group for you wherein you can post your observations. And you can share your findings with us. And that's all for now. Thank you very much.